Okay, we're going to proceed here to part four of our five-part series looking at supercells and tornado genesis. Here we're going to start looking at some of the environmental ingredients. How do we diagnose supercell potential based on the environment? And this is sort of where the rubber meets the road, combining the conceptual models with what we can observe. Okay, learning objectives, again, similar to the previous presentations. We want to relate the physical concepts of tornado development, and we'll cover that a little bit more in the part five, and then look at also how we relate the environment to supercell formation, and then look at the strengths and the limitations of two specific composite parameters, the supercell composite and the significant tornado parameter, and how you should interpret and use these composite parameters. Okay, recall the necessities for a right-moving supercell. We need an initial updraft, obviously, so we have to have buoyancy. We can quantify that with CAPE. We need vertical wind shear through a sufficient depth and of sufficient strength, and we'll talk about what we mean by sufficient as we go through this portion of the presentation. And then we have this updraft, tilts and stretches of vorticity, the ambient vertical wind shear to give us a rotating updraft, and this gives us the characteristic mesocyclone that is what makes a supercell storm unique. So how do we apply this? You know, it doesn't really matter. I can give you all the conceptual models in the world if you don't have any good way to apply this information. So I've mentioned before, we can calculate buoyancy from soundings. These can be numerical soundings from a numerical model generated that is essentially a forecast, or they can be observed soundings with the weather balloons, any sort of thing like that. Vertical wind shear, the real question comes in, what do we mean by that? How do we quantify this vertical wind shear? What depth, what sort of calculations are we looking at? Well, we need sufficient horizontal vorticity to be tilted and stretched, so we're going to have to look at the low-level shear to give us some indication of mid-level rotation potential. We also need enough vertical shear through a deep enough layer so that precipitation is transported away from the updraft, which gives us a longer-lived storm. It doesn't basically collapse on itself before we establish the whole supercell process. Okay, what do we mean by low-level shear? It's meant to indicate the storm inflow layer, so we're talking about something that represents the buoyant air that's feeding the deep updraft. So again, if the horizontal vorticity is not associated with buoyancy, it's irrelevant in terms of the mesocyclone potential. This is where we come to a concept known as the effective inflow layer. And this is essentially a thermodynamic check on the profile to see if there's buoyancy associated with the lifted parcels. So what we're trying to do here is we're saying, okay, we start at the ground, we take every available level in the sounding profile and lift it, calculate the convective inhibition in the CAPE. Did a bunch of empirical testing and came up with, as long as there's some CAPE, in this case at least 100 joules per kilogram, which is not much, there's a little bit of buoyancy, and there's not an excessive amount of convective inhibition, in this case represented by a sin of 250, which is pretty large. These are very easy to meet constraints. So the point here is if you can't meet these constraints, if the CAPE is less than 100, it's difficult to argue that you're feeding a deep thunderstorm updraft. If the inhibition is greater than 250, it's hard to believe that it's going to be, there's going to be enough lift applied to get that to a level of free convection. Okay, so we're going to illustrate it with a sounding. I know in this case we'll show another elevated supercell sounding. I like these oddball cases. So here's one that, just like in the part one, we showed an elevated left split. This one is actually a right mover that's rooted above the surface. And so what we do is we're going to focus on this layer in here, which is where the potential storm inflow might be originating. You notice it's a little too cold and stable right at the ground to potentially have a thunderstorm. And I'll illustrate this. And if you've seen these plots with the Python version of Sharp, you can get those online. Or if you come to SPC and look, or in AWIPS, you can look at the versions of InSharp in AWIPS 2. This is the illustration of the effective inflow layer. That little box whisker cyan type plot shows that contiguous layer of parcels that meet the CAPE and SIN constraints. So here's what happens when you apply this to a sounding, just to illustrate it. We're starting near the bottom of the inflow layer, or just below it. The lifted parcels all to the left of the temperature profile, there's no buoyancy. So this one does not meet the conditions. We jump up. Next parcel, aha, we have not too much inhibition, some buoyancy, so that's part of potential storm inflow layer. A little bit bigger buoyancy, it keeps going, we keep going, until we get up high enough to where we go above the moist layer and the buoyancy drops off. So the point is, if we go back through that just real quick, we're just trying to find all of the lifted parcels that potentially are part of the storm inflow layer. Okay, now we're going to use that inflow layer depth to define the layer over which we're looking for the vertical shear for the tilting and stretching of horizontal vorticity. So we plop that on a sounding. We want to look at, I take that inflow layer and I put the observed storm motion, which would be the apex of the little triangle here. So the observed storm motion would be here to the southeast. The inflow layer is the area sweeps out, goes from about a little above one kilometer up to just above 3 kilometers. So it's only the upper part of that red segment of the hodograph. The lowest part near the ground is too stable. So we calculate the effective storm relative helicity is just in that layer that potentially has parcels that could be considered storm inflow. Okay. We do this, we apply this to a whole bunch of cases with proximity soundings, you know, close in time and space to actual supercell events, and we'll show you exactly how this works. So here, when I do this overlay, the one I want you to focus on is this elevated right mover column right here. These are the storms that show the biggest difference when you apply the effective inflow layer. So if we go back, for example, over on the far left, this is a box and whisker plot. What it is a way to summarize like a scatter diagram. If you were to line up all the values from the lowest to the highest, the median, which is this marked in the middle of the box, that would be the middle value of the entire distribution, or the 50th percentile. So low values here, in this case we plot starting at the 10th percentile, 25th at the bottom of the box, the median is somewhere in the box, 75th percentile, and 90th. So we're showing 80% of the distribution of the data. If it's greater than 450 or so SRH in the effective inflow layer, or this would be 0 to 1 kilometer layer, we're not plotting it. And if it's less than about 100, we're not plotting it. So there's 20% of the distribution is either above or below, is not shown on this plot. This just shows the meat of the statistical distribution. So you notice here, this is the fixed 0 to 1 kilometer layer. It's pretty typical to have 200 to say 350 0 to 1 kilometer SRH with tornadic storms. And then you notice it drops off if we go to weak tornadic and non-tornadic storms. And if you look here, the 75th percentile for non-tornadic is pretty close to the 25th percentile for significant tornadoes producing storms. Now the interesting part is the elevated storms kind of cover a bigger spectrum. They sort of look like the non-tornadic, but they overlap a little more. We apply the effective storm relative helicity. You notice all the surface-based storms, which are over here, they all look real similar. So it doesn't really change the interpretation for the surface-based storms, but it makes a big difference on the elevated storms. You notice the effective SRH is quite a bit larger, but these are storms that are not rooted at the ground. But they may be strong supercells capable of producing very large hail and in some cases even damaging wind. So the point is we don't want to misinterpret the environment just because the buoyancy is not rooted at the ground. So this effective inflow layer gives us a way to calculate storm relative helicity for both elevated and surface-based environments. You don't have to know the answer before you start. You can actually use this as a starting point, and it'll give you a reasonable answer. And then, in this case, we normalize to typical values associated with supercells. In this case, it's about 50, because if you go to the far right of the diagram, these are marginal supercell storms and non-tornadic. So typically, once you get in that 50 to 100 storm relative helicity range, you start transitioning from non-supercell to supercell-type storms. Okay, what do we mean by deep layer? Same kind of argument. We need to look high enough to get precipitation removed from the updraft, and we want sustained supercells. Numerical simulations and observations suggest you have to look at least 5 or 6 kilometers deep based on typical buoyancy profiles. And so what we've done here is we've developed the effective bulk wind difference, and or some people refer to it as the effective shear, same thing, where we consider the cape layer of the storm, and then we just look at percentages, slices of the depth of that layer. Going to the same elevated supercell sounding, this is the entire layer from the bottom of the effective inflow layer, which is down here, bottom of our little whisker plot, up to the equilibrium level with the most unstable parcel. So we're looking for the vertical shear, some fraction of the shear in that layer, to say that that's what's going to be relevant to supercell formation. Okay, this is a plot looking in the sense of the box and whisker plots. What we've done is for the blue line, we are looking at what is the top whisker or the highest values of vertical shear calculated through those fractions of the cape bearing layer, starting at 10% on the left. That would just be the very bottom of the layer, a little shallow part, all the way up to 100%, which would be all the way from the base of the inflow layer to the height of the equilibrium level. So the non-supercell storms are in blue. So you can see that the vertical shear up here is can be relatively strong in the high levels, but compared to the red line, that's the bottom whisker for the supercell storms. So what we're looking for here is where are they most different, which would tell us where is the best discrimination through what depth of the buoyancy layer gives you the best discrimination between non-supercell and supercell storms. Well, anywhere the blue line is above the red line, that says there's overlap, that the non-supercell storms actually overlap into the supercell parameter space. But you notice in the mid-levels, they're almost identical, which says the bottom whisker and the top whisker almost don't overlap. They come to about the same value, which means these statistical distributions are quite offset. So what we've done with the effective bulk wind difference is focus on the difference in the shear vector over just the lowest half of the storm. Okay, so the effective bulk wind difference, it's very similar to the 0 to 6 kilometer shear in a typical case. Typical equilibrium level height's about 12 kilometers for a surface-based storm. The lowest half is 0 to 6 kilometers. So it ends up being the same calculation. The advantage is that it's more flexible than the 0 to 6 shear, much like the effective storm relative felicity. If a storm's elevated, we can account for that, and you don't have to make any assumptions going in. So you can actually account for it up front and not have to know the answer before you know what parameter to look at. So the advantage here is whether it's surface-based environment or elevated storm environment, you can still say something about supercell potential. And again, it also can account for very shallow or very deep storms. Maybe an example of a very deep storm would be like the Gerald storm from the late 90s in Central Texas, like nearly 8,000 Cape Day, or the Plainfield tornadic storm from 1990, where they have equilibrium heights up around 16 kilometers. The effective bulk wind difference looks high enough. Traditionally, those environments, if you're looking at the winds, like from the surface to say 500 millibars, which is about 6 kilometers, the shear suggested it's non-supercell. You go just another kilometer or two higher, and these suddenly look like supercell environments. And I promise you, those storms were not non-supercellular on those days. And then, of course, we can also look at elevated versus surface-based. So we've got a lot of flexibility, and we're not tied into just one number that is supposed to represent a bunch of different processes without considering those processes. Okay, so here's what it looks like. Another box and whisker plot with the effective bulk wind difference. These are significant tornadic or storms on the left. We go to elevated tornadic storms. All of these are supercells. So they all typically have, this is in meters per second, but you know, this isn't the American Meteorological Society, so we can use knots if we want. That's about 40 knots. And that's typical of supercell environments. Elevated surface-based, strong or weak tornadic, non-tornadic, they all look pretty similar. The marginal tornadic storms are kind of straddling those values around 20 meters per second or 40 knots, and then the non-supercells well below that. So if you compare the non-supercell storms to any of the supercell groups, there's virtually no overlap in the distributions. So it's a strong discriminating signal between supercell and non-supercell just using this effective bulk wind difference. Okay, so let's look at right-moving supercells and how we would quantify this. This is obviously a high-end example of one that I would like to see myself, but have not quite seen one that good. We've got the supercell composite parameter. So I've taken all these ingredients that we've been talking about and combined them in a way that helps highlight where these ingredients are co-located in time and space and to what extent. So we've got measures of vertical shear and buoyancy. And then what we do is we normalize those to climatological distributions. So we have proximity soundings. We can say, hey, what's a typical effective bulk wind difference? What's a typical effective storm relative felicity? You normalize to those values. And this is a case where bigger is better. You get larger values when the values are above climatology, and you get lower values when they're below. And when you take a product of these terms, you can actually have one compensate for another. If it's marginal vertical shear but very large buoyancy, or conversely, marginal buoyancy with very large vertical shear, you can still get positive outcomes. Okay, so what we've done here is we look at CAPE. CAPE is not a great discriminator between the various storm types, but it's a tremendously good discriminator between storm and no storm. You don't have a severe storm without a storm, so we need updrafts. Point here is typically the values on the left, these are most of the supercell cases over here, and these are other various types of storms, even disorganized storms that produce severe weather. Typically, most of those are above about 1,000 CAPE. So we just use that as kind of a rough starting point for what are we looking for, what's enough buoyancy, what's a typical value of buoyancy. So then we take the effective layer supercell composite, we take our version of CAPE, normalize it to 1,000 joules per kilogram, and then based on the other plots I've already showed, the effective bulk wind difference, 20 meters per second or 40 knots, and effective SRH of about 50. Now, the reason we're using a relatively low value of effective SRH is because we're talking, this one we're looking for positive favors right-moving supercells. You could conversely, and we do this for left-moving storms, you just look for the negative version. So you can just put a negative sign there. Negative SRH would just be anticyclonic in favor of left mover. So when we do this and apply it back to all the storms, and you use a value in the range of 1 to 2, on the far right, these are the non-supercells. They tend to fall outside the range. The majority of the distribution's below that. And virtually all of the supercell storms tend to be above a value of 1 or 2. And if, conveniently, these marginal storms that have a little bit of supercell structure, but they're either the rotation's too weak or they don't last long enough, they fall right in the middle. They straddle that transition. So it kind of tells us that we've got the right idea here. So again, most supercell environments are over about 2. And then down here, if you're clearly less than that, those are non-supercell environments. Now, one thing that's interesting here is we have a separate database of storms with the magnitude of the rotation. If we take how strong the storms are rotating and we compare that to the supercell composite values, which should be sort of a loose indication of how strong the supercell potential is, if you notice over here, the larger SCP environments, if you go on the axis, they also have they're more strongly rotating storms, cyclonically. And then the weaker SCP, they're weaker rotating storms. So it suggests that we are at least getting at the essence of the problem, that something in this combination of ingredients actually is reflected in radar observations of supercells. So we're at least kind of on the right track. Now, there are weaknesses. You can't just blindly apply this stuff. The first thing is this is conditional. An SCP of 50 means nothing without convective initiation. I mean, it means absolutely nothing. And you have to get the storm mode right. If you strongly force a squall line, you, in a sense, you're assuming a supercell's there before you have one. You have to have the right storm mode if you're going to apply this. Now, the strengths of it are, obviously, it's a simple estimate of supercell conditions could be met. So if you can get deep convection in this environment, it conditionally supports right-moving supercells. And it covers a wide range of environments. You can apply it north of boundaries where the buoyancy may be elevated. You can apply it in the warm sector. It can be low top cases. It can be the very deep warm season cases. And it looks like we have a reason to say that we have the physical basis in the relevant processes. So we've got parameters that are trying to reflect the relevant processes, at least in a crude sense.